This is your August astrology forecast. I am your host, Laura Chung, and Leo is my ninth house of foreign lands and foreign travel. So I've been traveling for the last 3 weeks. So please bear with me as I am holding up my mic and I'm experiencing some Mercury retrograde shadow moments here. It's very glitchy, but I wanted to do this to the best of my ability. And just as a reminder, I am a Western tropical astrologer. I use the whole sign house system. Great. So how was your July? I intentionally decided to rest and heal and travel. So I have to be honest, I took a little bit of a break off of social media, but clearly a lot has happened in the last 2 weeks alone, and I'm still processing a lot of the things that have happened. And most astrologers have predicted that something big was going to happen to Donald Trump and Joseph Robinette Biden, and it did. And the paradigms are shifting, things are changing in a massive way. I think I might have even mentioned in the July forecast that something was going to happen to Trump, just because I know his natal chart in my head. And also Joe Biden, because he has a Taurus moon, he has a Scorpio stellium, and he's a Sagittarius rising. So his Taurus house is his house of health. So this was not a surprise, but we're talking about archetypal energies, and you just can never predict how this is all going to manifest. So I think my biggest update for July was just that. Like, on July 13th, there was an assassination attempt on Donald Trump. Whether you believe it was real or not, it happened. His right ear was shot, and he was speaking at a, I think, convention, the Republican convention. So his midheaven, which in astrology is your legacy, what you're known for, is at 24 degrees of Taurus. And so the Mars Uranus Algol conjunction, all at 26 Taurus, was almost exactly conjunct his midheaven. And this conjunction was squaring to his 29 degree Leo rising, which is his physical body. So the fact that this was, I mean, any assassination attempt on a former president is going to get news, but the fact that it also hit his ear, and then like a couple of days later at the Republican National Convention, in a form of solidarity, people were wearing an ear patch, which I thought was interesting. And then also Biden got COVID, and he has a 0 degrees Taurus moon, which is it's an exalted moon in his sixth house of health. Hygieia, the asteroid about health, is exactly conjunct his Taurus moon. So this is not a surprise. Like, there are so many astrologers out there who predicted that Trump would get, something would happen to Trump, and also Biden would get sick and have to either leave the presidential race because of his health, or the Democrats would push him out. And I think both of those things happened. And also the Mars Uranus Algol conjunction was opposing his Scorpio stellium. He has like four planets in Scorpio. I believe his sun in Scorpio is at like 27 degrees in his 12th house. And so that activation of his 12th house, of things that are hidden, something became revealed that he was sick and that he would be stepping down from the race. And I think on the same day, he formally endorsed Kamala Harris, his VP, to run for president. So it's so interesting looking at all of their charts, because Trump was born on a lunar eclipse, and Biden was born right before a full moon, and Kamala Harris was born on the day of a full moon in Aries. So all three were born on a full moon. And all of this news and all of this stuff happened on a full moon at 29 degrees of Capricorn, conjunct Pluto at 0 degrees of Aquarius. Why is this significant? 29 degrees is the anaretic degree. It's the last and final degree of a sign because each sign has 0 to 29 degrees. So 29 is like a fulfillment, it's a completion of the sign of Capricorn, which we have been going through this Pluto and Capricorn era since 2008. And somebody in my comment section pointed it out to me that this is Biden's completion of his Capricorn story because in 2008, he was the VP for Obama, who was running for president in 2008. And he has essentially been on the ticket since 2008. So him bowing out, him stepping down at the full moon at the anaretic degree of 29 degrees is kind of his Capricorn, the end of his Capricorn story and his Pluto and Capricorn story. Conjunct Pluto at 0 degrees of Aquarius. 0 degrees is a critical degree. It's a world point. And Pluto in Aquarius is starting its new 20-year chapter. It's going to dip back into Capricorn between September and December, which we'll get into when we get to those forecasts. And then it'll be in Aquarius for the next 20 years, starting in 2025. But we're kind of getting like the little bits. Like the little hints of what this transit is going to mean for each of us individually and us collectively. Remember that the outer planets, Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto, are generational planets, and they're also transits that last for a long time. So it's not like, this little bit of Pluto in Aquarius is going to be the be all, end all of your story. And then July 16th, Mercury began its shadow phase. So, the 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks before the actual retrograde, which starts on August 4th, you kind of start to get hints of this of your retrograde story. And then, when it's in the retrograde, you're kind of reflecting, you're reviewing. My friend and colleague Stephanie Campos always says that a Mercury retrograde is like the cure for our capitalistic culture. It's like a moment to just pause and stop and reflect and look back at all the mercurial things you were doing. So then, yeah, I think I mentioned all of the things that I wanted to mention at a mundane level in July. I'm sure there was so many other things going on. I just wasn't paying as much attention as I was with this particular story, because clearly now Biden is not in the presidential race, and now Kamala Harris is. And now, in terms of like, and I'm using air quotes with my fingers, if you're listening to this version of the forecast, the leftist, progressive, liberal are all like arguing about who to vote for, right? The vote blue, no matter who. People are like, you have to vote for Kamala. And then the people who are like, burn it all down, are like, I'm not voting at all. And I just have to say that the far right fascists are so much more organized, and they have a plan because they've been in the nitty-gritty of politics for decades. Meanwhile, we're arguing over here about who to vote for. I'm not saying that you shouldn't vote. I believe that voting is your right. You have the right to vote for who you want to, but that's one thing that you can do in the bigger scheme of what we should be doing, which is planning, preparing, organizing, and building community. We are in trouble, people. And I'm not saying that to fearmonger. I'm just saying that so that we prepare and that we help each other. And my job in the collective liberation revolution movement is to bring awareness and to help you know your role in collective liberation. So if this resonates with you, and if my type of astrology resonates with you, I do personal readings. But this is like an overarching look at what's happening in the sky for all of us collectively each month. So, without further ado, let's get into August. So, July, we came off of Cancer and Leo season. We are now in Leo season, at least at the time of my recording. And Leo is a fixed fire sign. This is pretty much the like middle, I don't know if I would call it the middle of summer, but like the hottest part of summer, right? This is like fixed energy. From the middle of August to September, we go into Virgo season, which is a mutable earth sign. So we kind of start right away in August, with this very fixed energy. So fixed signs, the fixed signs being Taurus, Leo, Scorpio, Aquarius, you are all being activated by Leo season. And also, there are going to be a lot of squares and oppositions this month. August is such an interesting month because it feels like even though it's fixed, we're all being activated to change in some way. So throughout this season, there will be oppositions between Leo and your Aquarius stuff if you have Aquarius placements, and there's going to be squares between Leo and Taurus. Now there's also going to be squares and oppositions for the mutable signs. Mutable signs being Pisces, Gemini, Sagittarius, and Virgo. So there's going to be squares between Gemini and your Pisces house and Virgo and oppositions between Virgo and Pisces houses. And I'll explain this more in detail as we go on. And in the month of August, we have the following planets in retrograde: Saturn, Neptune, Pluto, Chiron, and Mercury. So there's a lot of reflection, reviewing, and just taking a moment to pause, possibly to see what is returning. Retrograde means going back. Not literally, obviously, it's just our perspective from Earth and the ecliptic and the other planets orbiting around the sun. So August 1st, Mars in Gemini will sextile the North Node in Aries. I'm bringing back the sextiles because we all need some, as much help as we can get, right? So in astrology, we have aspects, and that's how the planets talk to each other. The harmonious aspects are sextiles, which are 60 degree angles, and the trines, which are 120. This is where energy flows. This is like you're meeting up with a good friend, a bestie, and you have a really good conversation, and things just like flow, right? Now, the challenging aspects in astrology are the oppositions, which are 100 degree angles. Those are the full moons, and squares, which are 90 degree angles. Please don't take anything in a binary of good and bad. Nothing in the universe, in nature, is good and bad. Everything has a reason and a season. So in evolutionary astrology, they consider squares to be the most important ones because our souls want to grow, our souls want to change. Our human ego does not want that because it just wants to stay safe. It just wants to stay where it knows what's going to happen and it's comfortable. So everything I say, take it as like, yes, there's a human side of you that will enjoy the sextiles. It wants to just like yap with your friend and have a like a drink and catch up. But then there's going to be moments in the month where you're going to be challenged. Okay. So like I mentioned before, I went off in that little astrology 101 tangent. Mars and Gemini at 8 degrees will sextile the North Node at 8 degrees of Aries. This is a great moment to get after it. Okay. So the North Node is where our soul, our collective is growing towards Aries, which is the pioneer, the entrepreneur. It's all about self-sovereignty and self-determination. The ruler of the North Node, so the ruler of Aries, is Mars. So the North Node is literally speaking to Mars that's currently traveling through the sign of Gemini. Mars and Gemini can be argumentative. It can be a little gossipy. It can be a little, like way over reactive. But I would say this is a great day to communicate with people, to meet up with people. I think the whole month is good for that, to be honest with you. There's a lot here to be said about like the self and the collective. What is your specific role in the collective liberation? But you're only going to know that when you know yourself, Leo, okay? Moving right along, August 2nd, Venus at 26 degrees of Leo will square Uranus at 26 degrees of Taurus. So, squares, like I mentioned, are 90 degree angles. They're a little challenging because Venus and Leo like wants to have fun. It wants to flirt. And the Uranus part of your chart in Taurus is trying to change something that has been stagnant, has been staying still for a really long time, because Taurus is a fixed earth sign. So it's like fixed earth squared with fixed fire. Okay, that's like, trying to think of a good analogy, like an earthquake. It's like two tectonic plates trying to like both change at the same time, do what they want to do at the same time, but somehow they're not like in alignment, you know? But this is a great day too to just like, again, like squares are activations for change. Something needs to change. Taurus is ruled by Venus, so that Uranus is talking to the Venus in Leo. Venus in Leo is, I don't want to say like, because with each sign and archetype, there is a shadow and a shadow. There's a shadow and a light side, right? So, in the one hand, Venus and Leo knows what it wants, knows what it deserves, and is willing to get after it, right? It's a very like confident, it can be a confident signature, but there could be a shadow. Like Leo's shadow is needing to be fed through its ego, needing to be validated through external sources, needing to validate its worth by external forces. So there is something with your Leo and Taurus areas of your life that are asking to be changed and integrated. On August 4th, there are two things, not three things that are happening. So, depending on your time zone, this could be the day that Mercury stations to go retrograde. Venus will enter Virgo, which is in its fall. And we have the new moon in Leo at 12 degrees of Leo. And this new moon is happening at 7:13 a.m. Eastern Time. So it is significant, I believe, that the day of the new moon, Mercury's going retrograde. So it's like something is being seeded. There's a new beginning, there's new potential. But then also Mercury in Virgo is like, wait, but we need to like rethink this. We need to reflect on this. We can't necessarily move forward in certain aspects of our life. And during this time, when you're in Leo season, there's also going to be activation in your Virgo house. So these two houses are kind of like working in tandem together. I'm going to show the chart of the new moon. So if you are listening on the podcast version and you're curious to see the chart, you can head over to the YouTube channel. But if not, I'll try my best to describe what I'm looking at here. Okay, so a new moon is when the moon and the sun are together in the sky. It's called a conjunction. So we have the sun here at 12 degrees, and we have the moon here at 12 degrees. The ruler of the moon is the sun, because the ruler of Leo is the sun. So that's why every, I would say my favorite new moons to work with are the new moon in Cancer, the new moon in Leo, and the new moon in Taurus, because of like the rulerships, right? We have Venus here at the anaretic degree, at 29 degrees. We have Mercury here stationing to go retrograde in the sign of Virgo at 4 degrees. And let's see. So the new moon is making a sextile to Jupiter in Gemini. That's really cute. And let's see, anything else? So this is a beautiful new moon to plant some seeds around your, like, what you want to grow, right? The sun is our vital life force energy. The sun grows everything that it touches. And it's all about, like, leading from the heart and tuning into your heart and understanding what your authentic self is asking for you to express. And whenever I say that, I know some people might feel pressure, like, oh my God, I have to figure it out. There's no pressure. This is a new moon. So you have like a cycle, right? But this is where you can start to plant your seeds, plant your intentions, and look at what area of your life this is happening in. Look at where your Leo house is. So like I mentioned in the beginning, my Leo house is the ninth house, which is all about learning, higher education, spirituality, philosophy, foreign lands and foreign travel. So being in Leo season, I decided this is a great time to travel and really root into my spiritual practices. I'm also thinking about going back to school to study more, not like university or anything like that, but like learning, taking classes from an astrologer, an evolutionary astrologer, because I'm interested in learning that discipline of astrology. So this new moon is like, oh, of course, like it's right on time because this is my intention that I'm planting on this new moon. So just look at your Leo house and just know that like, this is an intention. You're planting something that you have to like water, you have to take care of, you have to like take daily action steps to make it happen. All right. So, let's see what else is happening. August 7th, the sun at 15 degrees of Leo will sextile Jupiter at 15 degrees of Gemini. And then Venus and Virgo will conjunct Mercury retrograde at 3 degrees. I really love this day, August 7th. You might want to circle it as a great day to like meet up with friends, like make connections. Venus and Virgo, like I mentioned in the beginning, is in its fall. So it's not necessarily going to be the Venus that would be in like Libra or Taurus or Pisces, right? Because when planets are in their detriment or fall, they don't have all the resources that they need to do the thing that they want to do naturally. And so Venus in these signs want to create bonds and they want to grow something and be abundant. And, you know, like Venus is the planet of love and relationships and of beauty. But when Venus is in Virgo, Virgo is a very independent, it's a very let's pay attention to the details kind of sign. So Venus and Virgo people are very, they're self-made independent people who don't necessarily believe they need to rely on relationships or community to help them in any way. And so again, we have to work out of this binary of good or bad. It's not that it's good or bad. It's just this, the Venus in Virgo functions in a different way. And so when this Venus is speaking to this Mercury retrograde in its domicile of Virgo, because Mercury is at home in Virgo and Gemini, Mercury has all of its resources. It can do what it needs to do. So Venus and Mercury are working in tandem together on something. This could be something, okay, like what I hear a lot in my comment, what I read a lot in my comment section is, okay, so what's the plan? Virgo placements love a plan. ask a Virgo, or call in some Virgo energy for yourself. Make a plan, organize something, join an organization. And then the Leo sextile Jupiter in Gemini, that's just like, how can I work with people? How can I expand my networks? Because Jupiter is a planet of expansion. In the sign of Gemini, it's all about making connections and collecting data and information. And so that Mercury retrograde in Virgo is also speaking to that Jupiter. By the way, if you're a mutable rising sign, so if you're a Pisces, Virgo, Sag, Gemini rising, two of your angular houses are ruled by Mercury and the other two are ruled by Gemini. And the angular houses are one, the first, fourth, seventh, and 10th. So when, right now, since Jupiter is in the sign of Gemini and that Mercury, every Mercury retrograde is going to be in your, it's going to be affecting one of your angular houses because Jupiter and, oh my God, Mercury is speaking to that Jupiter. Okay. So the mutable signs are, again, going to have a Jupiter in Gemini in one of their angular houses speaking to the Mercury retrogrades. So that's a big deal. Like, and two areas of your life, possibly even three or four, are going through a review right now. All right, so August 9th, Juno will enter the sign of Libra. Now, I don't normally bring up asteroids, but Juno is the asteroid of contracts and marriage. Well, because marriage was a contract back then. And so just look at your Libra house. Again, that is where the South Node is currently transiting. And I do think that is significant because with the Jupiter in Gemini and the South Node in Libra, and now Juno entering Libra, again, I think collectively we are just going to be entering new kinds of relationships and new kinds of contracts, for example. If you want to look more into this, I recommend Demetria George's books, The Goddesses and Asteroids. She does such an amazing job of like talking about and writing about the asteroid goddesses, Juno, Vesta, Pallas Athene, and Ceres, which is Demeter, Persephone's mother. They just add another layer to your astrology. So now that I've had that asteroid goddess side tangent, let's go to August 14th. Mars in Gemini will conjunct Jupiter in Gemini. And on the same day, Mercury in retrograde will re-enter the sign of Leo. So Mars conjunct Jupiter is like, I mean, it depends on your relationship to chaotic energy. if you have a lot of mutable energy in your chart, and I feel like you're just used to chaotic energy, but if you don't, then this could bring a lot of chaos, you know? Mars is the planet of action. It's the masculine, it's the yang. It's also the planet of getting after it. It's the god of war and the god of the underworld. And when it's conjunct Jupiter in the sign of Gemini, which it's not at home, and Jupiter is the planet of expansion, this could, okay, in the one hand, it can lead to a outburst of arguments or just like chaotic energy in terms of communication. Because again, that both Mars and Jupiter are answering to the Mercury retrograde, or this could be a constructive, since Mercury's retrograde, a constructive conflict resolution. Or maybe you're like reflecting on the way you are in conflict. And honestly, we need more of that. There is a content creator, I forget their name, but their handle is like 5HAHEM. I just shared their account on my stories today. They have a TikTok account and an Instagram account. They are therapist, astrologer, but they just recently started talking about how can we be better in conflict. And again, that also speaks to the eclipses in Libra and the South Node in Libra. I've been thinking about this a lot lately. How can we be better at communicating and being in conflict with other people that don't necessarily agree with us? Because if we all have to be in community with each other, and if we're ever going to create change and have any type of collective liberation, we're going to need to understand how to do this, and we're going to need to like engage with people in a different way. So that's August 14th. You might want to circle that just as a heads up. Look at where you have Gemini, around 16 degrees of Gemini, and see where you're being activated. I'm looking out for this day personally because this is like opposing all my Sagittarius placements. So I'm just like curious as to how this is all going to manifest. Again, these are archetypal energies. I can only give you possibilities of what this could entail, but how they all manifest, nobody knows. Like no astrologer, nobody can fully accurately predict the future. August 16th, Mars in Gemini will square Saturn at Pisces in Pisces. So this square is going to start applying now. Like I'm recording this on July 30th. It's already like building up to this moment. So most of August, you will feel a tension between your Gemini and Pisces houses. Gemini is all about collecting data, it's communication, it's just think of like the bee and how it buzzes around. And Pisces is the sign about faith and belief. So Mars being in Gemini is again trying to take action. It's trying to it could also sever ties. And Saturn is in retrograde, and so it's asking you to rethink your relationship to time, possibly your relationship to your belief systems and faith. Mars and Saturn are both malefics in astrology. They are the ones that cut and sever and contract, and the benefics are Venus and Jupiter. And so they give and they, expand and give us abundance. I feel like I'm a broken record, but please try to step out of the binary of good and bad. All planets, all celestial bodies are teachers. They just show it in a different way. So, for example, if you have debt or if you have like limiting beliefs around money and you have a Mars Saturn square, this is maybe the breakthrough that you've been waiting for around like a debt or around limiting beliefs around money, right? Just because you sever something doesn't mean it's bad, quote unquote. And or Mars and Mars square Saturn, like if they're in your like angular houses of like, let's say Gemini is your seventh house and Pisces is your fourth house. So maybe you're a Sagittarius rising, right? That could be like you want to be with your partner, but your family doesn't approve. For example, you're at like a challenging 90 degree point. Okay, so just look at where you have your Gemini house and your Pisces house. These areas of your life are trying to be integrated, trying to change in some way. On August 18th, Mercury retrograde in Leo will square Uranus in Taurus. And I mentioned this transit back in July when there was a square between Mercury and Uranus. When Mercury was direct. Here we are again. But now, since Mercury is retrograde, you might be reflecting and reviewing whatever happened back in June, J July, sorry. And both of these energies, like Mercury and Uranus, talk about like our nervous system. So on August 18th, just ground yourself, do some tapping, breath work, be outside in nature, walk on the earth. Like, don't get so easily triggered and activated on this day. I always say the malefics are going to malefic. Like, you have to give them what they want. So Uranus and Taurus is like, we want to change something that has been stagnant. And yes, Uranus talks about surprise, right? And unexpected. But if you're doing it intentionally, Taurus is also about step by step, take it slowly, this change. So just watch out for that. And then on the same day, the sun at 26 degrees of Leo will conjunct Mercury retrograde in Leo. And these days are great for downloads. These days are great for communication in some way. I mean, Mercury is still retrograde, so it's more about reflecting. I always find that the Mercury retrograde shadow period is the actual like communications, like breakdown, or when things are misconstrued. And the Mercury retrograde is the time when I use to like repair and like do some reconnaissance on what happened in the shadow phase, if that makes sense. So on August 19th, there is a full moon at 19 degrees of Aquarius at 2:25 p.m. Eastern time. Venus at 17 degrees of Virgo will square Jupiter and Gemini. Venus and Virgo will oppose Saturn retrograde in Pisces, and Jupiter in Gemini will square Saturn in Pisces, Saturn retrograde in Pisces. So it seems like Venus is making a T-square to Jupiter and Gemini. So a lot happening on this full moon in Aquarius. Okay, so here is the full moon chart. And I misspoke. Jupiter is the one that's making a T-square. A T-square happens when there is an opposition. So the opposition is happening between Venus and Virgo and Saturn in the sign of Pisces. And there is a square that is being formed by Jupiter and Venus in Virgo and Jupiter and Saturn in Pisces. That's a lot to take in if you, if you're a beginner level, but, a T-square is when there's two squares and an opposition, and they're all happening in the mutable signs between Venus, Saturn, and Jupiter. But let's talk about the full moon first. So we have the sun at 27 degrees of Leo, and it's opposite the moon in Aquarius at 27 degrees. And I believe the USA's moon is at 27 degrees. I'll have to double check that. But full moons are oppositions, and full moons are completions. They're a release. And then we have this opposition between Venus and Saturn, and then the two squares. Clearly, something wants to be released. Something wants to pop off, both in your fixed sign houses and your mutable sign houses. In and around this time, the full moon in Aquarius is when you're going to feel a lot of intense pressure, intense energies, and like something's got to give. Like, you might even be feeling like enough is enough, right? And I think at that time, a lot of us are going to feel that, because I mean, if you don't feel that already, I don't know. I feel like if you don't see that we are in a critical moment of change, then you're clearly not paying attention, or you're disassociating into a different dimension and space, which honestly, I don't blame you, but we need all hands on deck is what I'm trying to say. So the ruler of the moon, which is an Aquarius, is Saturn, and Saturn is here in the sign of Pisces. And Saturn in the sign of Pisces has been here since last year, and it's a 3-year transit. And so, thoughts and prayers to anybody going through their Saturn return. But the moon is speaking to Saturn in Pisces. The moon in Aquarius in a nation's chart is the people, we the people, right? If there was ever a signature in the USA Sibley chart that says we the people from the Declaration of Independence or the Constitution, it is its Aquarius moon in the third house. So this is at a mundane level, like collectively, I really believe that we collectively are being asked to remember our power collectively as a community. And it's speaking to that Saturn in Pisces in retrograde, like, okay, what do we believe? Like, what are our beliefs? What do we believe is possible for us? This is where we need to tap into our art. This is where we need to tap into our music, our creativity, our imagination, and our dreams. Because what we are accepting right now is like crumbs. Please know that we deserve better than this, please. And when you look at the opposition to Venus up there in the sign of Virgo, right, the USA has Neptune in the sign of Virgo, so it's going through a Neptune opposition. The USA, its motto is the American dream. But now we're all realizing the American dream has come at a cost of millions of people's lives. And also, what is an American dream if it's built upon genocide and ethnic cleansing and the enslavement of people, right? We are grappling with that as a country here. And so, Venus and Virgo opposing the Saturn, it's like, what can I do? What are my beliefs? What do I believe is possible? They are all, the Venus and Virgo is speaking to that Mercury retrograde here. That is conjunct the sun. Okay. What is my purpose? What is in my heart? Leo sun. And the collective's needs, opposing the full moon in Aquarius. Now, Venus and Saturn are being squared by this Jupiter in Gemini. Again, Jupiter in Gemini is not at home. Jupiter in its home sign and its domicile of Sagittarius and Pisces is belief, like a grand belief in a divine presence, the universe, something that you cannot see. It believes without even needing to see the proof. Jupiter in its opposite signs of Gemini and Virgo don't act, it doesn't act that way. It only believes when it has the data, the receipts, the proof. So it's, again, just because it's in its fall or detriment doesn't mean that it's bad or that it's like weak or anything. Jupiter just can't do what it wants to do. It just can't just believe like it does in Sagittarius and Pisces. Jupiter in Gemini needs to see the facts, needs to do its own research, which isn't a bad thing, especially with all the fake news that's going on. So this whole chart to me at an individual and collective level is this turning point in people's lives, this critical moment where you realize you are a part of a collective. You are not just a drop. You are an entire ocean in a drop, or whatever Rumi says. You have a responsibility by being authentically you, Leo Sun, to the collective full moon in the sign of Aquarius. How can I root into my belief systems and maybe some of those belief systems that we inherited from our parents are just not, they're not real. They're not valid anymore. They don't serve a purpose. For example, I am an elder daughter of immigrant parents, and they came to this country in the 70s, in their early 20s, and they had to bust their ass to make it work. Okay. There was a lot of trauma. There was a lot of racism, microaggressions that they had to experience. And so their experience of their reality is so different than mine as a first generation born in the United States, born and living in this information age, right? Technological age. It's just different. So what they're going to tell me and how to navigate life today in 2024, it just doesn't necessarily apply anymore. And it also is just outdated information. Saturn in Pisces. So what do I believe? Do I really believe that we have to work hard and kill ourselves? I don't know if I believe that anymore. There are so many people out there who work hard and kill themselves and are still not millionaires. You know, it's a symptom of our system, you know. The working class just never get ahead because that is how the system is built. So anyway, that was like a long tangent into saying that this moment, just look at this full moon, like physically look at it and just pause, do some reflection, do some journaling. Since it is an Aquarius moon, I have an Aquarius moon. I like to talk about these things with people. I like to share what I'm thinking, what I'm feeling, because the reflection helps me to understand more about myself. So again, this is all about community building, this era that we're in. But in order to create community, you have to build trust. And to build trust, you have to have intimacy and vulnerability. And in order to do that, you have to put down your ego. That is the shadow side of a Leo sun. Okay, wow. So after this full moon in Aquarius, we have August 22nd, Venus at 22 degrees of Virgo will square Mars in Gemini, and then the sun will enter Virgo, entering Virgo season. So Venus square Mars is, I think that's like attraction energy. It is like, it is grappling with the feminine and masculine energies, because Virgo is a feminine earth sign, Gemini is a masculine air sign, and they're both trying to do their thing, right? Mars is the planet of action and the sign of Gemini. Venus is the planet of receiving and receptiveness in the sign of Virgo. So with any square, again, something is being activated for you to look at the material, learn whatever you need to learn. And I hate saying this because it's annoying, because not everything in life has to be a lesson, but these challenges help us to grow into the people that we are always meant to be. So Venus and Virgo, you could have some kind of conflict with somebody, again, depending on where Virgo and Gemini are in your personal natal chart. There is an activation here. Maybe this is the time that you stand up for yourself. Maybe this is the time that you ask for a raise, whatever the case may be. Mars and Gemini is still speaking to a Mercury that's going retrograde. So you have to also think about, there's some kind of contemplation going on here. Okay, so yeah, both Venus and Mars are speaking to the Mercury that's retrograde. So then we are officially in Virgo season. Happy birthday and solar return to the Virgos and Virgo placements. So August 24th, Mars in Gemini will sextile Mercury in Leo. And this is cute because, again, Mars is speaking to that Mercury. This is a great day to send a message, do something that's communicative. It also is a retrograde still. So this might be something that you are replying back to when Mercury was going in its shadow phase. I'm just like, I just took a pause because I hear all these like noises. If you don't like animals or bugs, do not spend time in the jungle. There have been so many interesting noises this last week. I'm just always like, okay, what is in my room right now? And then on August 27th, Venus in Virgo will trine Uranus in Taurus. So remember back earlier in the month when Venus was square to Taurus on August 2nd. Now we have a beautiful trine. And this can be as a result of that activation. You took some, you did something to change, right? And now Uranus has this like lovely surprise because Uranus is speaking to that Venus and Virgo. So I really love this. Venus trine Uranus could be like a lovely surprise. Again, look at your Taurus and your Virgo houses. They're speaking to each other in an earth trine. That's cute. Personally, my Taurus house is the sixth house of work. My Virgo house is the 10th house of career. So I'm like, oh, am I going to get an unexpected like work opportunity, for example? Remember, these are all very macro level, very broad transits for everybody. This will be different for everybody based on your own natal chart and the houses. So, like, look at your rising sign and look at each of the houses that I'm talking about. And then you could tailor it to you. But this is a general reading. Don't take any of these things that I say personally. Just listen as a general like weather report, because just like the weather, when you know what's coming, you can prepare yourself for a rainy day, you can prepare yourself for a snowy day, and that's all it is. Okay, so I feel like I always have to give this pep talk every month. August 28th, Mercury stations direct at 21 degrees of Leo. Okay, yay. And then Venus at 29 degrees of Virgo, so it's at the anaretic degree, the last degree, is opposite Neptune retrograde in Pisces. Now, Venus opposite Neptune is always like a DeLulu signature. Like, if you meet somebody under this transit, they might look better than you think they do. Just FYI. Like, this transit, like in a week after this transit, after it like separates and you see the person again, you might be like, what was I thinking? But this is an also this is also a beautiful day to like create some art and like listen to good music. Just do something that's like a little bit maybe in like the dream realm. I'm thinking, you know, Neptune in Pisces is like it's all DeLulu, it's all imagination. It lives in the realms of dreams. And Venus and Virgo is a little bit more practical. It's like, I need to make a plan. I need to make, you know, I need to get organized. I need to clean my house, stuff like that. I need to get into my health routine. And so the Venus Neptune opposition might be coming to a head on that day of like, hey, maybe like I don't need to be that strict. For example, maybe my standards are not reasonable, for example. Okay, so August 29th, Venus will enter the sign of Libra, and Venus at 0 degrees will trine Pluto retrograde in the sign of Aquarius. Okay, this is cute because Venus is at home in Libra. So Venus has all of its resources. Venus wants to form bonds. Venus wants to have contracts. Venus wants art and aesthetics, right? And then immediately it will form a trine to Pluto in the sign of Aquarius. This can be you meet somebody and you form an instant bond. Just be careful because Pluto has a signature of obsession a little bit. But this could be like maybe you meet somebody in a group setting. I'm just saying because Pluto is in the sign of Aquarius, which is more like group setting thing. You have an amazing conversation with somebody, or you like reconcile with somebody after like a really long time. But this is like a beautiful, beautiful signature for relationships and community. Like I said, the overall vibe of August is like change. Like we have to change in some areas of our life. And for some of us, it can be multiple areas of our life, depending on if you're a fixed or mutable rising sign. But also, this is about understanding who you are, Leo. Virgo is about, again, having a plan, being organized, focusing on your health, and what we're gonna do for the future, okay? Because I feel like I say this every month. We are entering some of the most like tumultuous. I feel like tumultuous is going to trigger some of you. We are in the most revolutionary times of our lives. And I know this because of the cycles of astrology and history. These are the times that are reminiscent of the American Revolution, the French Revolution, the Haitian Revolution. Okay, we are in a time of revolution. Revolution just means change. So, in order for us to prepare, again, this is just the weather report, we're just re preparing. We have to truly know who we are. And because if we know who we are, we know our purpose and we know how to prepare. So, August is no different than any other month that we've been talking about. We're just preparing. We're just, again, unfolding to our true essence. We are building community because that is the only way we're gonna really get through this is together. But again, in order for us to even be in community, we have to like understand what it takes to be in healthy conflict and have nonviolent communication with people, which is why I believe there's all this Gemini energy and, Mars and Jupiter in the sign of Gemini and all these squares to the other mutable signs. So that is August. I love all of you. I appreciate all of you. I hope you have a healthy and emotionally regulated month. And as always, I love your comments, your emails, your DMs, letting me know how these transits are activating you. And as always, I am your humble servant and translator of the cosmos. Have a beautiful month. Love you all so much. Bye.